page 105 above.
And I look on page 105 nothing's
and
not
I
there.
See what
yeah.
I,
it's got Ascension Day, Easter week. We're coming up on it. Easter week, Luke, Corinthians, Isaiah.
Okay, there you go. That's why.
So I'll read this and flip it back to you.
If you would, this will keep it up.
All right. Okay.
Thank you. We continue on page 2 in your service bulletin. Hallelujah, Christ is risen. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray. O God, who for our redemption gave your only begotten Son to the death of the cross, and by his glorious resurrection delivered us from the power of our enemy, grant us so to die daily to sin that we may evermore live with him in the joy of his resurrection. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated for the reading of Scripture.
A reading from the book of Isaiah. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-aged wines, of rich food filled with marrow, of well-aged wine strained clear. And he will destroy on this mountain the shroud that is cast over all the peoples, the sheet that is spread over all the nations. He will swallow up death forever. Then the Lord God will wipe away the tears from all faces, and the disgrace of his people he will take away from all the earth. For the Lord has spoken. It will be said on that day, lo, this is our God. We have waited for him so that he might save us. This is the Lord for whom we have waited. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Today's second reading comes from Paul's first letter to the Corinthians. Now I would remind you, brothers and sisters, of the good news that I proclaimed to you, which you in turn received, in which also you stand, through which also you are being saved. If you hold firmly to the message that I proclaimed to you, unless you have come to believe in vain, for I handed on to you as of the first importance that I in turn had received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day, again in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. Then he appeared to more than 500 brothers and sisters at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have died. Then he appeared to James, and then to all the apostles. Last of all, as to one untimely born, he also appeared to me, for I am the least of the apostles, unfit to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace toward me has not been in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them, though it was not I, but the grace of God that is within me. Whether then it was I or they, so we proclaim, and so you have come to believe. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Then Peter and the other disciple set out and went toward the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down to look in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, following him, and went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple who reached the tomb first also went in, and he saw and believed, for as yet they did not understand the scripture that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples returned to their homes, but Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb and she saw two angels in white, sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and the other at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." When she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you looking for?" Supposing him to be a gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord." And she told them that she had said these things to her. The Gospel of the Lord.
I speak to you in the risen name of Christ, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. I have a sign in my office that I usually put up in my door at Easter time. It says simply this: a lot can happen in 3 days. Over the past 3 days, we have had a very, what I would call, emotive or emotional set of services, with a Monday-Thursday service that includes that intimate moment as we washed one another's feet, moving on then to the emotionally filled Good Friday service, whose liturgy alone normally fills us with enough emotion on its own. But added to that this year was a beautiful and moving composition by Deborah Carr and the choir that brought both the emotional darkness fully into view, but with it and in it, there was just this slight kernel of hope, which we hold on to until now, Resurrection Sunday. I would say a lot has happened in the past 3 days, but I think that a lot has happened in the past 3 to 4 months, from the beginning of Advent all the way to this Easter morning. Personally, I would describe it as though it felt like we were sprinting a marathon, the shortness of time of Advent moving quickly into the early season of Lent and now here before March ends at Easter. I will say this, though, and I say it proudly, St. John's was in stride. We had events, we had outreach, we had our Lenten suppers where 5 churches of the Episcopal Church in the region were represented. People were coming together for different reasons. And I believe, as I had mentioned often, that we truly lived into the seasons which all culminate to this great day of joy, which is Easter. The nice thing, again, deferring to the choir, this service will follow suit. Fittingly, we'll be closing with the Hallelujah Chorus. I wouldn't just stop at 3 to 4 months either. I would say that the past 3 or 4 years, albeit rough, came in as quickly as Holy Week, with that sudden stop that we were forced to take in the pandemic. And while I know it was only 4 years total, it seemed like a whole lot longer. And I think that we've come out of it adapted, taking a new way, sort of taking a new kind of resurrection to that period that was so dark and so hard. I was fortunate recently to have the bishop of the diocese help us and preach at a renewal of vows service that we do around Holy Week. And I think that she offered and adds some hope to give us all new inspiration to show the good news of Christ needs to be heard. Ironically, she started with an article in Scientific American. Not a place you'd start from a bishop's perspective. But the article was titled, Why Psychiatrists Should Get Down with God. It went on to describe that during the pandemic, some European researchers studied the word prayer during that period and throughout the pandemic, using 97 countries and Google as the reference point, they surveyed all the days during the pandemic that used the word prayer in the search box. There was one month where 55% of all searches included the word prayer. It also happened to be March of 2020. And the pandemic truly came into full swing. One other sad but true fact that was lifted up was that from 2018 to the present time, the rate of young people considering self-harm or struggling with their mental stability is well up over 50% in 5 years. And in fact, in their surveys of different people's mental health and mental perspective, all of them but one showed an increased struggle in their mental health, except for one. Now, it was a small percentage of about 4 to 5%, but throughout all of that, there was one group, one single group that reported a 4% increase in their mental health outlook during that same period of time. Now, this statistic adds personally to my joy. The only common denominator that they shared was that all of them attended a worship service of some kind weekly, either in person or at times online. They attended a worship service weekly. Wow. In our world of advertising, I feel that we are being bombarded from the pharmacology perspective. And in each one of those ads, we have to listen through to the legal advice and the horrible side effects that follow. I think I can offer a prescription. Come here weekly. No pills, no shots. And you know what? We'll even send you a reminder every week if you need it. I think if we stick to that plan, those who come weekly, if they did a 10-year study starting at the pandemic, I'll bet that category would grow exponentially on people whose mental health perspective is better. We have noted as well, at least I have, a great deal of lament about all the negatives of community and our society, especially it feels like over the past 3 months, I hear more and more people talking about posts where they are frustrated with their community. They can't feel like they live in a neighborhood anymore. Everyone is individual. They hearken back to the times when their neighbors looked out for each other and how much we've lost touch with that. Now, also recently, in the past 3 or 4 weeks, I quoted
a very interesting statement from the canon evangelist to the Anglican Archbishop of Canterbury. His name is J. John. And I think he offers all of us some insight on that loss of community. He said, if you're interested in going on mission, and in his case, he meant international missions or national missions. He said, if you want to go on mission, walk next door. Greet your neighbor. If you're interested in going on mission, walk next door. Have a conversation with your neighbor. Could be as simple as that. Just think if you came here weekly for the next year, the amount of community and connection you would receive. Maybe when you have those conversations on mission, or you inquire where or if your neighbors around you worship somewhere, maybe they'll join you. Invite them. We welcome them too. But I understand too that a lot of people have pulled back, and people have lost a little bit of trust in that kind of community. But if that's not something that they're interested in attending, maybe just start with some of the things we do here, whether it be a potluck or a breakfast or pancake supper, or get involved in delivering food to the needy, which we do, or invite them to give blood when we have the blood bank here. Or they could come help bring Christmas gifts to the children. They could also have participated, sorry, we're a little late, in the Easter egg hunt. Or they could come to the 12 o'clock coffee hour, which follows his service. One of the other things that has been moving, as I mentioned earlier, is a place that might be even easier than all those. Have them join us for one of the summer, winter, fall, spring choir concerts that are done here. Or maybe even just Taze to give them some quiet time. All these things we have been able to continue to do, and they have shown wonderful attendance and success. I'm not sure if I mentioned it at the beginning, but this story isn't just 3 or 4 months or 3 or 4 years. We can go back 3,000 years to our first reading of Scripture. Isaiah was written about 800 years before Christ lived. And as you'll notice, it was mentioned a shroud and a sheet being lifted, which is a reference directly to a burial garment being removed. It mentions death being swallowed up forever. Christ came to swallow death up for all of us. But we also have to remember that even before that 3,000-year marker, God started long before that. From the first interactions when we fell from grace, God began a plan to connect us back, to swallow up death forever, no matter how long it took. But here's the amazing connection, I think, to God's word and Isaiah. Before the middle of the 19th century, mid-1850s, there was a complete version that was accepted as Isaiah as a complete copy. It's from the 10th century AD, or 1000 AD, if you will. 1,000 years after Christ had read from it in the scroll and had taught from it many times. But that was the accepted version. And then there was that fateful day in Qumran where a boy threw a rock in a cave and heard something hit. That they were able to discover a complete scroll that was dated sometime 1 BC or 1 AD in the first century, around Christ's life. That area of Qumran is near the Dead Sea, and it was there
that they found the Dead Sea Scrolls. This was the middle of the 1800s that they were discovered. Some 2,000 years ago, they were written. And the only accepted version was only 1,000 years older than that. Here's the amazing part, and you can see it if you go to the Israeli Museum. That copy from Christ's time was almost identical to the 10th century version. These words of Isaiah we heard today, like the promise of the shroud being lifted, were the same in Christ's time, the same as the accepted version in the 10th century. Those words continue. We can and should have faith in the words of our gospel. We see Mary weeping when she entered the tomb after Peter and John had come in and saw it empty, only left with a shroud. They went home, still a bit confused about what was happening. If we pause here for just 1 second, and if you wind back to the words we always use in the scriptures of the Maundy Thursday readings at the Last Supper. Christ said to Peter, "You do not know what I am doing now, but you will later." But Peter, still confused, went home. Mary went in weeping, unafraid, and this is important, unafraid when she saw two angels. Usually when people see angels, the first thing the angels say is, "Fear not." She came in, no matter what, unafraid, and then begged someone who she thought was a gardener, after she saw the burial shroud, to tell her where the body was, so that she could properly bury her Lord with that shroud. But once again, as we know from the beginning of John, the Word became flesh. She heard the great shepherd's voice, but it wasn't until Christ called her as a shepherd would by name and said, "Mary," that she knew and responded, "Rabboni," or "Rabbi." Christ did something there in teaching her and explaining to her something that he had explained long before to John the Baptist after he was imprisoned. If you remember, people came looking, and John, and he said, "You go tell John what's happening with the ministry." It was then that John knew, as Mary knew, Christ was alive. And God's love and ministry would continue then and still continues to this day. Now, as you came here today, which is joyous to see all of you, it's a wonderful feeling. Whether you feel as if you're staring into an empty tomb or you are absolutely overjoyed at Resurrection Sunday, I think today offers us all a new start. Now, for those that might be in that point of emptiness, if I can help, please call me. Please reach out to me in some way. Or if you are ready to step into a new chapter of joy at this resurrection, we have kept busy here, and we can always use extra hands for any of the many ministries we try to keep going. You can call me then too. I'll still answer. But regardless, the one thing I think I would urge of all of us, given the brokenness of this world, is taking up that challenge of some kind of weekly worship. And if you know somebody that needs a boost, invite them to join us. But if they're not ready for that, you can simply send them our services, which we stream live. We even stream just the sermon portion if they want to kind of test drive the word. Each and every one of you, this day forward, can be a spark of light that shines into someone else's darkness. Share that light, knowing that God is here and God loves you. as well, not only God, but the St. John's family, looks out for and loves all of you. And I truly do make it my best effort to love each and every one of you. So as you go out into the world joyfully, share that light. It is that important. Share it joyfully. Sharing that light that indeed the Lord has risen. Hallelujah. And the Lord has risen indeed. Hallelujah. And all God's people said, amen.
Prayers of the People are Form 6, taken from the Book of Common Prayer, page 388, and you may find them on page 6 in your bulletin. Let us pray for the Church and for the world. Grant, Almighty God, that all who confess your name may be united in your truth, live together in your love, and reveal your glory in the world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Guide the people of this land and of all the nations in the ways of justice and peace, especially for those involved in the wars in Ukraine and Israel, that we may honor one another and serve the common good. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Almighty and gracious Father, be ever present and so guide and direct our minds and hearts as we seek a faithful and caring pastor for St. John's Church. Please grant us the wisdom of discernment and sustain us during our search. All this we ask through Jesus Christ, our only Lord and Savior. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Give us all a reverence for the earth as your own creation, that we may use its resources rightly and in the service of others, and to your honor and glory. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Bless all those lives that are closely linked with ours, and grant that we may serve Christ in them and love one another as he loves us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for Justin, Archbishop of Canterbury, for Michael, our presiding bishop, and Susan, our bishop, for Mark, our cleric, and all bishops and other ministers, and for all who serve God in his church. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. Give them courage and hope in their troubles, and bring them the joy of your salvation, especially those on our prayer list. And you may add your petitions here. Amen. 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 Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We thank you, Lord, for the birthdays of Don, H, Solvay, John, Ann, Dan, and Nia, and for the anniversaries of Connie and Don, and Nancy and Vestal, and for all the blessings of this life.
Thank you for this day.
Amen. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We commend to your mercy all who have died, that your will for them may be fulfilled. And we pray that we may share with all your saints in your eternal kingdom. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, hear the prayers of your people and what we have asked faithfully. Grant that we may obtain effectually to the glory of your name through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now continuing, let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Will you stand if you are able? The peace of the Lord be always with you. Just have a couple of quick things to announce. But while I'm looking for that, I also want to say thank you. Thank you to the choir, to the staff, to everybody who worked so hard, volunteers galore, that made Holy Week so special. Not only for me, but I think anyone who was here. And I really appreciate it because you don't realize what you don't know or you hadn't done until you do it the first time. Fortunately, I had a bunch of people that were looking out for me, asking those probing questions. Like, are you sure we do that? Very helpful, trust me. But it is wonderful to see everybody here. Really, there are plenty of announcements on pages 10 and 11 for you to read, mark, and inwardly digest. I will point out two things that I think are important after our Hallelujah chorus. Please join us as InReach has sponsored a coffee hour over in the parish hall, which is through those doors and to the right. And just follow the smells. They smell wonderful. Also, too, we have some cards if you're visiting, would like more information, or need to reach out for me in any way. They're green, they're white. Fill out any of them. I will answer them. One other thing, because I mentioned it as well, we are closed on Monday. The office will be closed on Monday, but fear not, as the angels say, if there really is any concerns that you would have, there is an emergency contact number for me, and if I can't get to the phone, I will pick up very shortly and return any calls of need. I don't want that to be left unsaid. Other than that, I will leave the rest to you. Walk in love as Christ loved us. I did this twice in a row. I made the choir stand up. I stopped halfway through because for some reason that prompts me to remind everyone halfway through that we are using our 1618 silver. And I say that simply because the chalice is rather large. And as some experienced this morning, you can get more than you bargain for if you aren't careful. So I think it's important to point out that we're using that silver so that you don't end up tilting too far. Now, walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God. Our service continues with Eucharistic Prayer A. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and good, thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. But chiefly are we bound to praise you for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. For he is the true Paschal Lamb, who was sacrificed for us and has taken away the sin of the world. By his death, he has destroyed death, and by his rising to life again, he has won for us everlasting life. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Your preference. Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love, you made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you, in your mercy, sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ is alive.
We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ. By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
"Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen."
Alleluia, Christ, our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia.
These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Thank you. Eternal God, Heavenly Father,
you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart through Christ our Lord. Amen.
The peace of God which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you forever.
Amen.
In the name of Christ. Thanks be to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.